Hello, Malty Magnifiques. Ralphie here, on location in Speyside, and it's not even raining. How good is that? And I'm sure a few of you will appreciate that we are on location. We're out and about in the countryside and outside some fancy castle, which is very nice indeed. And more than that, we have a special guest, someone who is fairly significant when it comes to whisky on the internet. His name is Serge. He is the proprietor of whiskyfun.com, one of the most consistent, informative websites, and well worth your perusal. Easy to find. If you're not sure, just Google it. Furthermore, Serge is one of the earlier members of the society called the MaltManiacs, that group of malt heads who provide such useful facilities for us, including the Malt Matrix, Malt Epistles, yes, and the Interactive Malt Map of Scotland. Hello, Serge.
Hello, Ralphie. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you, my friend. Now, you have the advantage over me, sir, because you've got a glass of whisky and I haven't.
Yeah, I'm sorry, you can have
a sniff. I'll have a wee sniff. Thank you very much indeed. Malty. I'll leave it at that. Tell me, Serge, can you remember your first glass of whisky?
Well, maybe not my first blend, because it may have been any blend in some Coca-Cola a long time ago. But I remember very well my first malt whisky.
Right.
It was in Scotland. It was in, I think, 1978, so it was a long time ago. And I came to Scotland with some friends, and I was just trying to find the Holy Grail, which was at the time actually Glenfiddich, because it was the only one you could find easily. But we found a real Highlander, and we asked him, can we have malt whiskey? Do you have malt whiskey? He said, yes, I have some. So he poured some Glenfiddich 12 and then went straight to the fridge and came with some Canada Dry. Mm-hmm. And he just droned the malt whiskey into a huge quantity of ginger ale. So, well, the first experience was a bit strange, but he said that was the way at the time to have it.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Yes. Now, you mentioned you were looking for the Holy Grail of whiskies. Have you found it?
I hope not. Otherwise, the quest would be over, you know. So what's important is the trip, the journey, and I think there might be somewhere the best malt ever, which is subjective, of course. But of course, I'll never find it. Mm. Hopefully.
Quite. Now, on the subject of looking for the Holy Grails, you're probably in a very good position to recommend, I'm putting you on the spot here because there's no rehearsals, as you malt mates very well know, but I'm going to ask you to recommend a readily available budget single malt or blend. I'll leave it open to you. I'm going to ask you to recommend something that's mid-priced, and I'm going to ask you to recommend something that's expensive, but you know to be of particularly good quality.
That's easier. That part is much easier. But I would say, depends on the number of bottles. First thing, I would buy several, not only one, not just one. I would buy probably, of course, a peaty one from Isla. Could be Lagavulin, Laphroaig, or Ardbeg. Then I would buy probably another Isla. I would buy a Bruichladdich, the new 10 years old,
mm-hmm, yes,
which I like a lot, and which is not very expensive and very shiny on shelves with its aquamarine colors. Always
very, very distinctive.
Exactly, you can't miss it. And then, of course, Bayside. I would buy some, probably a Glendronach, mm-hmm, but maybe the 15 years old, the revival, which I really, really enjoyed. It's a full-bodied, heavily sherried whiskey, so very different from the others. And then maybe a lighter one. Why not a Blair Athol or something like that, a Midlander, and probably a Highland Park as well.
Mm-hmm.
And a last one, maybe a Kleinlich.
Right.
Which I enjoy a lot. And so you would have a very wide selection of very different whiskies.
Mm-hmm. All good whiskies, all readily available.
Yeah.
Are there any older whiskies, perhaps more expensive, because people tend to be unsure and about the risk of spending your money on mid-aged whiskies, perhaps older blends, and the risk of being disappointed. But in terms of intrinsic quality, just three whiskies that cost a bit more.
I would go for the ones that... Oh, you mean a bit more, or frankly more?
Quite a bit more, but quite. Not hugely expensive.
Oh, not hugely. That's the grey zone. That's not the easy zone. Mm-hmm. So I would probably go for the same names that I mentioned before, mm-hmm. but I would go at independent bottlers and try to find a single casks from Kleinlich, Artbeg, Freud, all the same names, and then maybe compare these single casks whiskies, which are usually a little more expensive, to the regular entry-level whiskies, and it's always very revealing, and I really like them.
Of course, with the independent bottlers, you tend to get that predominance of non-chill filtration, no additional colour added, and a higher strength of alcohol.
Exactly,
and
exactly.
That can make all the difference.
Of course, exactly, yes. Exactly.
And some shockingly expensive and obscure whiskies that you know to be of intrinsic quality.
Yeah, I would go for some peaty ones. I would pick a Brora 72 if I can find one, but I just saw one in Edinburgh yesterday, and they tried to sell it for £1,600.
Oh, for goodness sake.
And that was too much.
£1,600, even Serge can't find it. What chance have the rest of us got? Is there anything a little bit more?
But the other, the official 30 or now 32 years old Brora, yes. I would definitely buy it. Because it's really a slice of history, Scottish history, mm-hmm. nice story, great whiskey,
yeah.
and always great. Mm-hmm. I would probably buy a Porter in the same category. And then I would go for a closed distillery and other closed distilleries, because I think it's time to buy some of them, yeah. before you just can't find them anymore. Mm-hmm. And probably Glenugie, Glenlochie, which are great, great, great whiskies. And Glenask as well. Glenask is a little more obscure, mm-hmm. I think. But Glenugie and Glenlochie, or Glenlochie, I don't know.
Glenlochie. As we've seen, it's gone.
Ah, that's a throat disease, it's not the language. I'm sorry.
No, you're a fair point, yes. That's the wonderful thing about the internet. It's opinions. We're all presenting opinions. We're not trying to preach facts here.
No.
And that's one of the wonderful things about this phenomenon. It's only 20-odd years old, but it lets people who might not necessarily get books published or be professional journalists and all the rest of it, but have experience. That's the key, sharing our experience, putting it out there, because the feedback we both get is how much it's appreciated.
Yeah, I think so. You know, it's a bit of fun for us to do it and then to share what we do. I think you probably have the same feeling. It's a game. It's our main hobby. It's my main hobby today, and I'm happy to see that some friends and people go to the website and read it. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I'm surprised, but I'm just trying to have fun. I think this is really the main thing. Otherwise, if you just try to mimic And the professionals such as Charlie, Dave, and all these guys who are so much better than I am, I'm sure, and I know. Just a matter of having fun and sharing sensations and things you feel about whiskey, and that's all.
Yes. Yeah. You know. And but as the old distillers say, you cannot beat experience. And I know that people watching may be a bit frustrated because they don't feel they're getting all these tasting notes that you and I discover in whiskey. Is there three pieces of advice, Serge, that you would give people in order to get more out of whatever whiskey they're drinking?
What I always do, I think it's very difficult to get all the what's in a whiskey if you just take a dram and try it like this, like what I'm doing just now, and then start to write tasting notes and even give a score, which is the ultimate. So I'm always trying to compare whiskies that are similar. So I would always try to taste, for instance, five Laphroaigs or three Macallans things like that. And this is maybe more difficult to do because you have to source the whiskies. But then it's much easier to do when you try them, because all the nuances would come out, you know. And if you compare three Laphroaig, you would find those notes of grapefruits, whatever, that maybe you wouldn't find if you just try this Laphroaig on its own, or if you compare it to a Macallan or something, which is frankly different. So that's what I'm doing.
So you're getting points of reference.
Exactly.
So rather than someone pour one glass of whiskey, to pour a couple of glasses of whiskey and then contrast and compare them gives you a point. Yeah, a point of reference.
And the other thing I do, I always start with a whiskey that I know very well. Mm. And which is very well known by everybody, such as Macallan 12 years old or Laphroaig 10 years old. And this is another way of calibrating your senses and be sure that you're in good shape, because one day out of 2 days you're not in good shape. It's like if you want to run, I mean, sometimes you're very slow. And I think it's exactly the same with the nose and the palate. So if you want to check if you're in good shape, the good way to do it is to try, for instance, Macallan 12 years old. And if you find it just as usual, and you would score it just as usual, you can go on.
Yeah.
And that's the way I try to do it.
And your third piece of advice?
Third piece of advice, trying to keep it fun. I mean, if I'm not in the mood for tasting whiskey, I just won't do it, you know. And otherwise, it's kind of... It can start to be like a job, you know, and if it's a job, it's not fun, not absolutely always fun, and so I just won't do it, and that's it.
So there you have it, maltmates. Serge says, keep it fun. Absolutely right. Taking things too seriously can turn a hobby into a chore, and we don't want that, because you look back, and it's the happiness and the joy that aids the appreciation and helps make the moments more memorable for us all. Now, one final question, Serge. What's the future with your website, whiskyfun.com? How do you see it developing in the future?
It's a very good question, because it's going to be 10 years old this year, in July. And frankly, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know. Could be a good occasion to just stop, you know. I don't know. I'm not sure. I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe I say, okay, 10 years old, that's it. Mm-hmm. Maybe. Or maybe taste something else. Maybe find another setup. But I'm not sure. Or just go on.
Yeah.
I don't know. We'll see. I don't know. I have no...
We shall wait and see. But thank you so much, Serge, for giving us a few minutes of your time, and I'm holding you back from your whiskey there. Is it? I didn't even notice you sipping away. There we go. Shows you how much I pay attention. But there we are, folks. Another vlog on location with one of the notable personalities, yes, in the online whiskey scene. There we have it. Thank you for watching, and I hope you'll join me soon when we will be having a few more malt moments, either in the Manx Bothy or out and about. Goodness knows, I never plan that far ahead. Thanks, Serge, and we'll see you soon.
Bye.
Bye-bye. I'm going to see if this thing works. It always does this. Absolutely useless. Could you hold the microphone, please?
Sure.
I'm going to have to switch this camera off the old-fashioned way.
Yeah.
If you want to sing a song while I'm having it, just you carry on.
Just go on watching Ralphie's vlogs, please. They are so excellent.